Hey, Dustin Tibbetts here, financial advisor with Jazz Wealth Managers. How's it going today? Hope you're having a good day out there. Hey, it's one of those markets where it's known as a stock picker's market. So we're going to spend some time just talking about what analysts are talking about in terms of their individual picks that they're suggesting to their customers. We get all that great data here, so I'll share with you some of it. We share a lot of that data with our customers just so you can kind of see what are the high net worth people being told. I sort of take all that information and put things together for them to help them out in our weekly classes. But basically, we've got a market here where you can't really just afford to throw money at anything and take a shot. It's the whole game plan of what's going to do well if we recover from this virus. What's going to do well even if it takes longer to recover from this virus. And a great example is actually what Goldman Sachs put out to their customers. I'll share that with you here. I shared this on the Closing Beat, by the way, which is our live stock market update show that we do every day. And basically they said, okay, let's look at both sides, right? Let's just see what we think in terms of if it takes longer or if we recover quickly. So on the chart screen here, what we did is we put together a few of those names and some of what Goldman Sachs was saying. This is not my recommendation. This is, of course, theirs. But they were saying, okay, what if we recover quickly? We think Caterpillar, Chipotle, Regeneron, Salesforce, Uber, those are some of the names that would do well. And then above the chart there, you can see some of the reasons why they made those suggestions. They were very bullish on Caterpillar, number one for the yield, currently at 3.3% as we're talking. More attractive in a low rate interest rate environment for farmers and construction personnel to go out and buy some of this new higher tech type equipment. Obviously, Chipotle would be doing well, people going back out to eat and everything, although they've got this, the Chipotle apps, and now some of the new locations have Chipotle lanes, kind of like a drive-through Chipotle, which I think is brilliant, by the way. They had some comments about Uber and, of course, Regeneron working on some of the pharmaceuticals there for the virus and would stand to do well from that if they do create the vaccine, or even just one of the lead candidates there would be great. So that's what they put on that side. Then they said, okay, well, let's just assume this is really a big issue and we don't recover that quick. What stocks would benefit if this is an extended sort of prolonged recovery for this? They've got Activision Blizzard. They make video games out there. They were obviously bullish on that with people wanting to stay at home and play games. I mean, that's what my daughter's doing. Amazon, of course, has done well through this whole virus there. Lockheed Martin, they think, would benefit from increased government spending and that being a consistent flow of money, if you will. McKesson actually does well through all downturns. It actually handles itself pretty well. I'm going to see if I can go over real quick and pop this up because I want to bring this up if we can. Yeah, I've got it here for you. So if you look back at McKesson through the last two recessions, and the recessions are highlighted in gray in the background there, the 2008 pullback there, and then, of course, the dot-com bust. You can kind of see in purple what the stock market did in terms of the S&P's total return through both recessions there. And you see how McKesson basically held up. Now, you're going to have to deal with some volatility there, but that stock did hold up, and that was one of the reasons that Goldman Sachs added that to their list. They've got a $174 price target, which is the biggest potential gainer in their list if you were to go through the entire list. And Procter & Gamble just being one of those sort of staples that makes the that kind of holds up through the rough times there. What I want to do is elaborate a little bit more on some of this for you. Let's go through some different stocks, and you let me know down below what stocks you think would hold up or do well through this, what we're going through right now. I'll start with J.P. Morgan. J.P. Morgan was rather bullish on Disney. Now, this is kind of unique. I bought the Disney Bob Iger's Masterclass, so I've kind of got to go through the history of his decisions of breaking the company into different pieces. But if we go to Disney, J.P. Morgan says that they're really positive on the stock because of Disney Plus. So Disney Plus is in what's known as their direct-to-consumer category, and Disney Plus just had 50 million paid subscribers that they hit while we're all sitting at home watching TV. People are giving Disney Plus a chance here. And so J.P. Morgan says that with that Disney Plus rollout, even though they've seen some delays around the globe there, they expect that to obviously benefit customers staying home and to help generate a good, solid, stable base of what's hopes to be long-term customers there. One thing that I want to point out, I'll add to the mix here, just so I'm not reading off analyst comments for you. We broke down Disney's revenue by segment, right? So every company, most companies have different segments that they break their revenue into. And so, with the parks being closed, we wanted to kind of take a look and see how much that's going to hurt the company there. I'll share this on the closing beat a little bit later today, but you can see on the right-hand side of this slide, we've got parks, products, and experiences, which are basically the theme parks themselves, the surrounding areas that you experience, restaurants, restaurants and things like that. Disney Springs down here in Florida to be one of them. Products would be the things that you buy while you're at Disney or that extend into toys and products that you might buy after visiting Disney. So it's not necessarily stuff you buy while you're at the parks, but products in general. That makes up the bulk of their revenues. They've got 35% of their revenues as of their fiscal 2019 quarter there. All the way off to the right is their direct-to-consumer. That's 12.5%. That would be where Disney Plus is going to fit in going forward. It's only 12.5% with 50 million paid subscribers and being a new offering for Disney. You got to imagine that that side of it is going to help support the downturn here in, not having their theme parks open. One other thing I'll add to that, it's kind of like when Apple, if you really think back to Apple, they sold products. They sold iPhones and remember the old iPods they used to sell? And so that was a hardware company. They would hype a great product. They would offer the product. You'd go buy the product. Now what Apple's doing is getting into services, or they have been getting into services, where they're saying, okay, you've got our products. Everybody that wants one can have one. Now let's keep getting revenue from them by getting them to use Apple TV, Apple Pay, Apple Arcade, things like that. So while you have the product, you're spending money using it on their services. So you've seen their services segment grow like that over the time period. I think it's like 24% of their revenue now is services driven. Well, think of Disney in the same way there. The direct to consumer area could sort of be considered like services like Apple was. That's what Disney's trying to do. They're trying to get up into that sort of area of revenue from the services division there. All right, moving on here. Analysts at Baird are rather positive on McDonald's. How could you not be? You know what I mean? How could you not be positive on McDonald's there? They said they've got plenty of liquidity to support their franchisees. They've been through this whole type of mess before. Maybe not such a unique mess, but they've been through this and they will be able to support their franchisees. Not to mention their drive-thrus. People are still there. The McDonald's by my place. There's two McDonald's that I actually pass on the way home. They're just freakishly busy, so people are out there buying. McDonald's has done a lot of things to help support healthcare workers and things like that as well, but that doesn't really translate into revenues. One other thing I want to point out, and I'll go to the chart to share that. Did you know McDonald's typically does really well during recessions? I'll go back two of them just to share with you here. Let's look at McDonald's. I did the same thing, put recession charts in the background there. That'll be your gray shaded area. Held up nicely. It's your purple line through the dot-com bust there. Basically was flat, chopped around, little volatility had to withstand, but it didn't really suffer through the recession. If you go over here into the last great recession there, McDonald's actually finished out positive going into that, right? So you've got the markets, obviously, that was a disaster, selling off hard. McDonald's did well through that. And so Baird says, hey, this is typically one that holds up quite nicely. And we think that it'll be fine. So Baird rather polish positive on the on McDonald's there. So that's another one I want to point out to you. And finally, we'll go over to, I think it's a tough one. This one's a bit tough here. Susquehanna, known for being obviously very statistic-driven, very data-driven. These guys don't mess around. It's a very bright company, and I'm not picking on them in any respect. Very, very, very good company. But anyways, they said, you know what? We like Crocs. The rubber shoe company, right? So Crocs, if we look at the stock, it's down 50% this year. So maybe they like discounts. They're contrarians, maybe. I don't know. Stock market down 13 as of this taping here, 50% on Crocs. You could see it's obviously more volatile. It's been hurt more. But what they're saying for Crocs is that, look, about 18% of their revenue comes from their e-commerce business. They're essentially making a bet that that's going to be improved, that they're going to do well there. They think you're going to see double-digit increases during this virus and their e-commerce business, which will help bring it up in terms of the amount of their revenue or percentage of revenue there. Also, they've got some proprietary things that Baird used to decide that that's what's going to happen. I don't pretend to know those, but that was their basic input on Crocs. And I thought that was kind of a gutsy call there. We'll see what happens. This video will be up forever, so we'll see how it goes. Hey, just a different way of looking at things for you. Just kind of wanted to bring some different data to you. I hope it's helpful. It is a stock picker's market. I'll probably focus on that on our Wednesday video. But I do appreciate you watching. Come join us for the closing beat later today. I hope you have a great rest of your day. And, subscribe, like, all that great stuff. Check us out at Jazz Wealth and be safe out there. Enjoy.
Why should you choose Jazz Wealth as your retirement or long-term investing service? Our portfolios are managed by us, not some faceless mutual fund manager. Our private classes will teach you everything about investing and getting your dough straight. Best of all, our fiduciary standard means your best interests comes before ours.